The commission will come to order. And good afternoon and welcome to our hearing on the escalating violence facing Coptic women and girls in Egypt following the Arab Spring, including the outrageous crime of abduction, forced conversion, and which the Egyptian government, both old and new, is doing all too little about, if anything at all. Dr. Phares, please proceed.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, members of the Commission, I would like to thank you very much for extending this invitation to me to address this very dramatic issue of persecution and of abduction of girls and women in the Coptic community in Egypt. I have titled my paper, my presentation, as The Strategy of Subduing a Community by Terrorizing Its Women. And thank you, Mr. Chairman, for including the full text of my testimony in the records. What I would like to do for the sake of time is to summarize the following. First, from a strategic perspective, what are the findings of our colleagues this year and last year in this body, in Congress, and also in the European Parliament, if I may, have been telling us? What are the major points that we can respond to? From there, I'd like to ask five questions and answer them that would allow the Commission and therefore members of Congress and our government in general terms to respond to the challenge. The violence against Coptic women in Egypt, as many experts have already testified before this prestigious forum over the past few years and last year in particular, these acts of violence against Egyptian Coptic women, both individually and collectively, have been unrelenting, repetitive, and directed almost exclusively at young, single women and who are at age of marriage or just about. This violence, which is described in several reports already submitted to your nation, to Congress in general, to other legislative bodies around the world, can be summarized as follows. A, the attacks have been ongoing for more than three decades, with peaks in some years. B, the victims have primarily been young Christian women. C, Egyptian security and judicial authorities have not helped, in general terms, the families of these girls and have not actually conducted an investigation, a thorough national investigation of who is that network in Egypt that basically has been perpetuating those attacks for the last 5 years, at least documented. D, an overwhelming majority of the kidnappings and violence have been carried out by individuals and groups who claim to be acting on their ideology, on behalf of their ideology, a doctrine, a set of fundamental beliefs known as Salafism or Jihadism, which they claim is the strict implementation of Sharia laws. C, an overwhelming majority of these crimes have been dismissed by government security and justice institutions, and the radical factions have been protecting many of these perpetrators, assigning essentially blame to the female victims and their families. F, violence against young Christian women in Egypt has continued after the downfall of the previous regime and the formation of the current alternative government and its institutions. These findings, Mr. Chairman, prompt the following questions, five of them. A, have the attacks been widespread and consistent over time, so that we can deal with the argument of this is just a reaction to a love affair or a social situation gone bad? Is the history of these attacks reflective of the legal and security status of the Coptic Christian community at large? Two, is the violence committed by an organized movement or by individuals who claim to be acting on behalf of an ideological movement? Three, does the attitude of government, security, judicial, and political institutions reflect cooperation with the attackers or just neglect for the protection of a segment of Egyptian society? Four, what are the consequences of the continuous attacks against Coptic females and thus the Coptic community despite the regime change, of government change, and the rise of new institutions in Egypt, which I feel is a key element in our discussion today? And five, what can and should the United States government, specifically the administration, do to put an end to these violent practices against the women of Christian Coptic community? Answering those questions or attempting to do so will equip members of the Commission and thus of Congress with the perspective needed to understand the exact nature of the crisis and make informed recommendations regarding possible new legislation and alternative policies for adoption by the executive branch. Point number one, the nature of these attacks. According to prior research submitted to your commission and to other congressional committees, targeted attacks against Coptic Christian women are not unrelated and isolated acts of violence. On the contrary, kidnapping and forcing captive women to convert to Islam has been documented for decades, revealing hundreds of victims each year. Research and Coptic sources claim that the violence against Coptic women has been practiced since even before the rise of modern Egypt, but current research is confirming that this abuse was documented for at least the last half a decade or decade, especially in the last 5 or 3 years. Therefore, the first characteristic of the crisis is its long-standing history. This means that any solution to the problem must address its historical roots and scope of the violence. This violence against Coptic females took place before and after the Arab Spring, before and after 9/11, before and after the end of the Cold War, and before and after World War II. We are dealing with a threat that has the dimension of an attitude by either a movement or an ideology with regard to the Coptic community. Now, with regard to the perpetrators, while research over the past 5 years, I must admit, has not revealed a well-designed structure that openly and officially takes responsibility for these attacks against Coptic Christian women, it has shown, however, patterns and statements that indicate the existence of a movement that hails from a well-publicized ideology, namely Salafist, namely Islamic fundamentalist, or also known as jihadism. In almost all cases, Mr. Chairman, the kidnappers argued that their actions were legitimized and inspired by Salafist and jihadist principles. One central tenet that most of my colleagues have mentioned already this year and last year, one central tenet of those principles is that individuals, in this case females, who convert from Christianity to Islam cannot revert back to their original religion, must accept their quote-unquote forced marriages, and in some cases families of the victims were asked to pay a tribute to recover the daughters. The reference to jihadist views applicable to Christian Copts in general and women and girls in particular shows that the acts perpetrated against them and their communities are ideologically and politically motivated. Government failure and collaboration. We also detected that, based on reports by human rights groups as well as Coptic community and liberal Egyptian NGOs, that local Egyptian police and security forces, national security agencies, including the now gone state security agency Amnet Dawla, are on or were either covering up the attacks or protecting the perpetrators. Therefore, when we look at the historical timeline of security collaboration with the perpetrators or, at a minimum, non-support to the victims and their families, this coincides as well with a timeline of similar aggressive behavior against the community as a whole. Coptic activists and NGOs, including the Washington, D.C.-based Coptic Solidarity International, have accused Egyptian security services under the Mubarak regime of using Salafists to conduct attacks against Coptic targets to maintain the community under the protection of the government. Coptic and liberal Egyptian NGOs have argued that the new security agencies formed after the collapse of the Mubarak regime, after the latest legislative elections, continue to allow these practices or help the perpetrators. Consequences of attacks against Coptic women, which I consider one of the most important key analysis in our discussion. If the aggression targeting Christian Coptic women continues and widens, without a determined and aggressive intervention by the Egyptian government to put an end to this practice, there will be serious consequences on Egyptian Christian women, their own communities, the Christian Coptic community, but also on Egyptian women in general, leading to a weakening of civil society and a dramatic setback to freedom, to human rights, and democracy in Egypt. The chief consequence of unchecked aggressions against Coptic women and the terror is basically the terror it is instilling in the hearts of Christian women who count for at least half of the 15 or so million Christian Copts in Egypt. The hundreds of repetitive attacks against Coptic women send a clear signal to millions of young women in Egypt who feel targeted by the jihadists and Salafists, compelling them to limit their movements, to narrow their social circles, and to separate from Muslim communities. So violence against Coptic women leads to a de facto gender apartheid in Egypt, where Christian women will be increasingly deterred from finding jobs, from expressing their opinion, from wearing their own preferred outfits, and circulating in public spaces. The effects on Coptic women will also extend to the entire Christian community, as half of its members are increasingly intimidated by acts of violence committed on hundreds of young women. When one segment of community is terrorized, it reverberates throughout their families and communities, forcing the collective into mental ghettos and therefore emigration. Rape, abduction, and forced conversion are among the root causes of a general sentiment among Copts that pushes thousands of them to flee the country of their ancestors. Outside the community, the attacks against Coptic Christian women and their results will bring other consequences, Mr. Chairman, to bear on secular Egyptian women in general, meaning Muslim secular Egyptian women in general, both liberal and conservative. By failing to protect its Coptic citizens, the Egyptian government would be perceived as incapable of protecting other segments of the population also targeted by the Salafists and the jihadists. Muslim, liberal, and secular women who already fear the strict implementation and enforcement of the jihadi view Sharia law will be under increased pressures by the most extreme elements of the Islamist movement to wear the hijab and later the full niqab. The attacks on defenseless Coptic women are a mere prelude to a wider campaign to impose its ideological agenda, clearly seen in the Salafist movement as early as 2011. The role of the U.S. government, finally, the United States government has an international responsibility in addressing the situation in the same way our U.S. foreign policy has addressed mass-scale abuse of human rights around the globe for the last 20 to 30 years. We recommend for the Helsinki Commission to adopt the following steps as a way to help protect Coptic women and girls in Egypt from abuse and defend their universal rights. One, reaffirm the conditions on global U.S. foreign aid to Egypt, despite all the debate that has been taking place in Washington about it, of a constitutional provision announced by the drafters of the new Egyptian constitution that the practices of abducting, torturing, and forcing conversions on Coptic women or any element of society is a terrorist act which is punishable by law. This is not an infringement of their liberties, it's a terrorist act. Kidnapping in Colombia is a terrorist act. Kidnapping in any part of the world is a terrorist act. Two, make a congressional declaration that crimes against Coptic women inspired by extremist ideologies targeting communities will be considered crimes against humanity punishable under international law. There are no differences between rape and aggression against women in Egypt and what happened in Yugoslavia or in Bosnia or in Kosovo. Three, partner with Coptic and civil society NGOs, extending financial support directly to these entities as part of the global USA to Egypt. If you want to send foreign aid to Egypt, if you want to send hundreds of millions of dollars, we also need to earmark part of that aid to the NGOs that are representatives of the weakest elements of the Egyptian society, that will be women and minorities. Four, ensure that the educational and informational system in Egypt, particularly state-supported institutions, which we are funding, by the way, isn't used to propagate the ideology and precepts used by the perpetrators of the attacks as a